When I miss the light, the night is stolen. When I'm slamming all the doors you've opened, hold on to me. Hold on to me.
I'm David Stork. I'm a funeral director. I own Stork Funeral Homes and Historyland Memorial Park. I've been a funeral director for almost 40 years. Some years ago, I talked to a friend who had experienced the loss of a loved one, and they told me that the only thing that got them through those days after that death was walking. You know, in mortuary college, when I was a young man, we had a class called Psychology of Grief. And in that class, we learned about a lady named Elizabeth Kubler-Ross, who wrote a book about the stages of grief. And in that book, she basically detailed that most folks go through about 5 stages of grief. The first stage is denial, then it's anger, then it's bargaining, then it's depression, and finally acceptance. They're just thrust into it. And no one says, hey, by the way, your dad died, you need to take a class. And so I thought, what better way to prepare people for what they're gonna do is than to have a place where they could come and walk as a part of therapy and learn about the stages they'll possibly go through. So we created a 1/4 mile beautiful trail through the woods here at Historyland Memorial Park. And there are 5 stations along that trail. And each one of those stations have a bench and some signage that kind of talks about those 5 stages. And folks can come and reflect and read about what they're going through to kind of have a roadmap of what they'll experience in the coming months and years. So when we started planning the layout of this trail, I thought, what would be more appropriate than to ask folks that we had been with through our funeral home who had been down this path? And so we reached out to a young man named Matthew Amato, who lost his mother. We reached out to a widow, a lady named Carla Halfpap, who had lost her husband, and talked to her about her walk of grief and the stages she had encountered. We talked to 2 daughters of a lady that we'd handled her funeral, Brittany and Casey, who had experienced the loss of their mother, along with all of their aunts who had died of cancer. We spoke with Dawn Hahn, who tragically lost her son as a result of an automobile accident. And then I felt compelled to share the story of the loss that I had. 11 years ago, I lost my best friend. And after that, I became a much better funeral director because I got to experience exactly what the folks that I had been helping all these years were going through.
So I don't really love talking about everything that sort of led up to her passing. To sum it up in very brief words, I will say that she was diagnosed with a heart condition. She had open heart surgery that went very badly, and she came out of the surgery with a heart that was essentially going through heart failure. You know, you keep thinking back, all right, well, what if we didn't do that surgery? Or what if we had done something different years before? Or what if this did happen? Or I could see the bargaining in there. And of course, obviously the depression. I think whenever you lose anybody, there's that blanket of sadness that surrounds you. And you look at the last one of acceptance. And I think for many people, I think we kind of look at that and kind of shrug it off almost as a laugh. Like, how does that, you know, how is that ever going to happen? And I don't, it almost feels like the loss just can happen sometimes over and over again, even throughout a week or throughout a day, or sometimes it just hits you in such weird ways. So it's hard to, just doesn't want to really accept that reality, your new reality. It's coming to terms with your new life without somebody. Well, I think, that's again, you know, like one of the things that, you know, I'm an adult, you know what death is, right? But you talk to the people you love, and you hope they hear you. But that silence, that's the worst part of grief.
Our mom was diagnosed with cancer in February 2021. We have a really bad family history of cancer. We've lost all of our maternal aunts, and two of them were to cancer. So our mother had shoulder pain. We just assumed it was like a torn rotator cuff or something like that that could be easily fixed. They did an MRI and found that it was cancer. And even before she could get any further testing, she knew, she could tell in her body that it had spread to other areas. And she kind of knew that because of her sister's own health and her process with her metastatic cancer. So she was diagnosed in February 2021 and she passed in April 2021.
That's a little bit of a blur for me, I feel like, right now. I can't recall many specifics.
Yeah, I would say I definitely felt very numb.
Yeah, we just handled things as they needed to be done.
And I feel like I've seen other people do that. You go to viewings or you go to a funeral and you're like, how is their family so strong? But I don't know, you just do it. But because you're just getting through it, I feel like you process it later on. So then it hits you harder later on. And outside people, I don't think understand that, that you think, oh, the passing and the services would be the hardest, but it's really later on when I think you're able to process it more when you're more alone and more isolated and it's more difficult. I think mine was mixed more with anger. This isn't fair, you're such a good mom. And I remember having this conversation with her. I was like, I have a list of people he could take instead that are like really terrible people or terrible moms. Can we like trade? I remember when she first passed, I'm like, I feel like it's written all over my face, like at work, like this girl's mom just died. But now, I guess it felt like it was the like main part of me, like the only part of me. But I know there's like those things where your grief doesn't get smaller, but you grow around your grief.
Accepted is a hard word because I associate that with it's okay and it's not okay. So I guess the answer for me, if you look at it like that, would be no. I'm upset that she died. I'm upset that all of my aunts died, like our whole maternal side is gone, and I think we're too young for that. We don't accept the fact, like, I feel like we both talked how we're searching for that mother figure. Even though I'm supposed to be my own little adult now, like, you always want your mom. One of her things she was really insistent on, and I think of it all the time, is grieve and go. And so even now when, you know, we always talked about in our family, like, it's good to get the tears out, like, it's okay to get them out. So I still don't know if I believe her on this one. She said, it's gonna be okay. It's not gonna be okay right now. It's not gonna be okay very soon, but it will be okay. It's still not okay.
Hi, my name is Carla Halfpap, and my husband passed away. Arthur Halfpap Jr. passed away on May 27th, 2022. I'd been married before to an abusive husband, and he was like my Prince Charming, and it's like God finally gave him to me. A big gentle giant. He was 6'8", a teddy bear, but you get the teddy bear, you know, in a fuss, he'll get really furry, and it hit so fast. He was supposed to have 6 months and he died within 3 weeks. So we had talked about, you know, his feelings about it. He didn't want the priest to come yet because he didn't feel like it was happening. And then when it finally hit, I didn't really get a lot of time to say a lot to him. He was like me. He thought, well, 6 months. You know, he's 6 months with us. But he, at the time when 6 months, when they gave him that diagnosis, he was talking and, you know, normal. You go into this denial that you come home and you think you're gonna hear his truck. Like when you're in the kitchen with the grandkids and you hear the garage door open and it's my son and you think it's his truck. I mean, it's just, or I think in the middle of the night I roll over and then I forget. I'm just very sad still. More than anything, I have lonely times, like The nighttime is good in a way, because when everybody's, you know, around and you can have the lights on low and you look, and then, and I do one thing every day that helps me. When I take a shower, I write messages to him on the glass. Every, you know, when it's foggy, and I write him a message every day, what I'm feeling, or I miss you, I love you. But every day there's something. It helps me. Well, the only good thing that, like I said, I have to hold on to is that I have good memories. But people mean well when they say it'll get better in time. That's the wrong word. It gets easier in time, but never better, because better is here with you. I mean, I just hope people, you know, can hear it and see that it's not ever gonna go away, and it's not ever gonna get easier. I'll probably be feeling like this until I die, because, I mean, I just can't understand how to get over it. I mean, I'll be here, and one day I'll be there.
So 11 years ago, I experienced the death of my best friend. And my best friend was a gentleman that was old enough to be my father. Actually, if you do the math, he was old enough to be my grandfather. His name was Gordon Smithers. And he worked at the funeral home when I first came there to work as a 21-year-old kid. And for 25, almost 30 years, in all those five stages of grief, I didn't experience any of those except one. And that's the thing about grief. You may not go through them in a particular order. You may not hit all five stages. But with Gordon, you know, he was old, and he'd had a sudden but lengthy illness, and so it was expected. So, I wasn't angry. I didn't deny anything. The thing that hit me the hardest was about a week after his death, was depression. He was no longer gonna be a daily part of my life. It was just, I was sad. So my deal with Gordon was depression, or I'd rather call it sadness, because I don't really know what depression is. I just know I was sad. And I wanted to be sad. I wanted to listen to sad music. It goes to the depth of your relationship, and I don't want to diminish it one bit. And I wanted to keep hurting, because I wanted to prove that I'd lost something. But eventually, you know, I got to the point of acceptance. I'm not going to lie to you. I still go by Green Lawn Cemetery. And, you know, he's not there. I'll go to his headstone. I talk to him. And I could do that from anywhere. But my big thing with him was sadness or depression. And I'll have it for the rest of my life. And I don't want to ever lose it, because that's how much he meant.
My name is Dawn Hahn. I am the video producer of this documentary. And I too have suffered the painful stages of grief. My son, James Trivett, died 11 years ago from a single vehicle accident. He was only 21 years old. The accident happened on April 9th, 2013, on Coldwater Road in Caroline County. There was no witnesses of the accident, so we have never known why he was driving 70 miles an hour on the road, or what caused him to veer off the road and struck a tree. When the sheriff showed up at my house later that night and gave us the news that my son was killed,
I don't remember much. I remember sobbing, being on my knees uncontrollably, not knowing what to do. Sick inside. You just numb. And that's something your body doesn't get over, the shock. Have to question yourself, because that's where the denial comes in. And I just couldn't believe that. You know, even if this is true, let's bargain. Take me. Don't take my son, who is loved by more people than I even know as the days went through his funeral afterwards, it's the worst. She really gets sad. Sad and depression is just, it's gonna be there. One night, probably about a couple months after James's death, I was just sitting outside talking to God. I was really angry. How can you put me through this? How can I live through this? How am I ever gonna get myself back up? Tag, anxiety, everything triggered just back. And I couldn't breathe, I couldn't talk. And I can tell you that it hurts so bad. You can feel your heart breaking. Spiritually, he came through me and I felt and experienced a shock pain go through me. And I know that was him telling me that I know your pain. We're gonna get through this. To get through this is with your family, friends, community. I felt a lot of guilt for a long time because I wanted that bargaining to work. I wanted it to be me or some other bad, evil person that didn't need to be in this earth would go instead of James. You know, let's just turn back the time and it's each day, you're still gonna have that pain, but it's just a matter of holding it down and dealing with it and making it a part of life and just trying to push that pain aside and move forward and be strong for everyone else here who has been so strong to me.
Hold on to me.